You're listening to The Table Talk with your host, Anthony Irvin, a.k.a. Spoken Life. Tune in every other Thursday starting at 7:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time with me and a new special guest live on Facebook and Twitch. Let's start the show. What's up, everybody? Welcome to another episode of Table Talk. My name is Anthony Irvin, your host, a.k.a. Spoken Life. Welcome to episode 14. We have an awesome special guest for you tonight. We have a lot to talk about. It's an old friend of mine. We were actually in a band together. So this is a first for the show tonight, a former bandmate of mine. So we'll be able to reminisce on some band moments. Maybe we got some funny band moments we might be able to remember and give you guys a couple of laughs. And so hope you guys had a great week. Let's get to our special guest tonight. We have a lot to talk about, so let's bring in our special guest, Kevin Sitaras, everybody. Hey!
Hi!
How you doing, Kev? What's going on, brother?
I'm not far enough away from you.
You're never too far away from me.
Where's your mask? I don't want your COVID.
I know. It's... can we actually get...
Where's your mask, Anthony?
Can we get contacted from here? I'm not sure.
This is making my glasses fog up anyway. Hi.
That's not an excuse not to take off the mask, buddy.
And I was just around like 30 people too, so I'm like, I'm totally going to give you the Rona.
Oh, yeah. Way over here. Yeah. I'm going to have to go back here tonight.
Yeah. The distant land of Florida is so close to Pennsylvania.
I know, right? It's like a hop, skip, and a jump,
Yeah, something like that.
So how was your day?
Uneventful. Actually, this was one of the few days in a while where like I didn't have something kind of crazy happen, or I didn't have fires to put out, or wasn't, I don't want to say a nightmare, but it wasn't a lot of stuff going on. I have my finger in a lot of different pies, so to speak. I manage bands now, and I have my own bands that I deal with, and then I teach full-time. Right. I started a teaching business, so it's been interesting, to say the least, but because of that, my phone is basically always going off and driving me crazy, so days off don't really exist for me anymore.
Right.
So, what about you? What did you do today?
Nothing too much, typical work. For those who do not know, I work as a microbiologist during the day. And all right, guys, we are live again. We're going to do a little sweep of the share again just to make sure that people who are watching the previous stream are going to come back. Restarted the stream.
Do I need to share a different link?
Your page, please. I think all you have to really do is just if you just refresh the band page, it probably should just come up. But I'll just continue what I was talking about. Basically, from the fact that I work in a lab that revolves around probiotics, and the fact that probiotics have been growing in the last couple years with the knowledge of what probiotics have really become, because it's really not much of a concept with bigger doctors, because probiotics aren't really much of a drug. So now that a lot more nephrologists and doctors are starting to see the benefits of it, they're starting to actually put it to better use. So
yeah. Did you get your master's or?
I did get my master's at Westchester University. Back in 2018. It's crazy to know that it was almost like a year and a half.
Lord, what's your master's in?
It's basically a master's of science in biology, general biology, you'd say.
You gonna go for your doctorate?
Everybody keeps asking me that, and it took me 6 years to do the master's because I was still working with the while going to school, so I was doing night school and everything. So yeah. I don't think I'll be going for it right now, but unless somebody pays me, then I'll probably do something like that.
Dr. Irvin.
Dr. Irvin.
Dr. Spoken Life.
I know, right?
Or it'd just be Dr. Life, I guess.
So to bring people back into, you know, who are just watching the stream and coming back, because we had a little bit of technical difficulties there. Kev, why don't you give a proper introduction to yourself as the musician you are?
Sup, I'm Kevin, and I'm the musician that I am.
that should be a band name.
The musician that I am. So I have been a career musician for, God, I don't want to tell you how old I am. Well, you know. So I'm 33. So I've been a career musician for going on 8 years now, I guess. I start off in an amazing, amazing band called Lesser Known Heroes.
I wonder if you were going to bring that up.
How could I not bring that up? Come
exactly.
on. Now, I quit music for a while when I was like 24, and it was like right when I started dating this one girl, and I decided to like focus on the relationship for once in my life and go back to school and stuff. And then she was like, "You look miserable. What the hell's wrong with you?" And I was like, "I don't know. I'm not in a band." So started playing music again. And ever since then, it's just like everything kind of started to go right, I guess. So I did a record with a band called Better Class Criminal. And then from there, I met my producer, Bruce Wigner, who's actually blowing up right now, which is kind of crazy. So I, after I met Bruce, I started going in there recording my own music, because I'm primarily a drummer, as you know, but, I do play guitar and sing too. So I started tracking my own music just for fun, just to see how it would sound, because I'd written songs, but I never like actually recorded them. So I put them out, and originally I wasn't sure if I was going to put them out, and then I decided to. I posted them to a website called Reverb Nation. Which we all know and hate, I'm sure. So put them up on Reverb Nation, and kind of joked when I posted them, like, oh, wouldn't it be funny if like I climbed the charts on Reverb Nation? And then I climbed the charts on Reverb Nation. it was like the first day I put my first single out, and I was like, oh, cool. Like, I'm in the top 20 for Philadelphia. That's amazing. And then I checked again. I was like, I'm in the top 10. And then I looked like an hour or two later, I'm like, I'm in the top 7. And then I was like in the top 5, and then the top 2, and I was right behind Bianca Ryan, who Bianca Ryan was a chick from Philly who won America's Got Talent, from Philadelphia,
right?
And I was like, wouldn't it be hilarious if I kicked her ass out of number 1? And I did.
and you did.
And I was like jaw on floor when I saw it. I was like, what the fuck is going on right now?
And you know, Reverb Nation, it's me, like you said, it's like a almost like a love hate thing. Like, no offense to Reverb Nation, but you know, I think it's like, you know, because I was in that same predicament too, that, you know, they had like the charts and everything. I'm like, well, that'd be cool if I got into like the top 20. And then you get into the top 20, and then like a couple weeks later you're in the top 10. You're like, oh, what's going on? And and you start getting into the top like 10, top 5 of Philadelphia for a little while. And yeah, it's you know, it's definitely a boost of confidence for you.
Oh yeah. And like when I originally went in to record the songs, I was like not necessarily planning on releasing them. It was just kind of like, I'm curious what this would sound like and if I'm even capable of doing this. And excuse me. So I finally just decided, out of the hell with it, I'll post it and at least my friends will get to see it. So when I started to watch it climb the charts, I was like texting my mom, and I was just like, you're not going to believe this. Like, I don't know how significant this is, but like, I'm a charting artist in Philadelphia. And she was like, what does that even mean? I'm like, I don't know either. So, and then like later that day, cause it all happened within a day, but like later that day, she was like, oh, so where'd you go on the chart? I was like, oh, I'm like number 5. She's like, how did that happen? I'm like, I don't know. So, and then she asked me again later that night. She's like, oh, where are you at? I'm like, oh, I'm number 1.
like yeah, wow. Look at me. I'm number 1.
Yeah. And it's funny too, because like growing up, my mom always, I always would say like, I want to be a singer. I want to be a singer. And my mom's like, you play every instrument in the world. Why do you care about being a singer? And I'm like, because I would give it all up to be able to sing. It was just something I always wanted to do. And she was like, well, some people are just not singers. You should just be happy with the talent that you have and, you know, all that other shit. And I was like, yeah, I know. But, and I started going to vocal lessons and practicing more. And then all of a sudden I was like, oh, I can sing. You know, just I had to work on it. And to anybody that thinks that you're not a singer, take it from me. You can be. Trust me.
Right.
So after after that band happened, I'm super, super proactive about my career. So I scanned Craigslist in like 10 or 15 cities pretty much every single day looking for opportunities to see who's looking for musicians or whatever. And not as much anymore. I'm a little bit more retired now, but back then it was like every day I was looking at Nashville, LA, San Francisco, Austin, New York, Boston, Atlanta, Orlando. I'm trying to think where else I looked. All of like the major big cities. I used to like pull up a list of the most populous cities in the country and I would go after them. I looked in Toronto too. And I would post ads in those cities and I would read every ad I could find about who was looking for what. And, oh, thank you, Anthony. You're the sweetest.
thanks so, for watching, Anthony. Thanks for Tim. That was Tim saying, I didn't know you guys knew each other. it's a small world.
Yeah. Eventually, this band called Rivers Monroe had posted something that they were looking to boot their drummer or they're having disagreements or something. Come to find out, the bass player just hated the drummer, and he was the one that posted the ad. So me and him started talking, and it was about a year from that conversation that I got a call that he was just like, hey, we're actually we're going on tour, and he can't do this tour. Do you want to do it? And I had never toured before. So I was like, yeah, I'll do it. And I came in, and when I came into audition to be the touring drummer, their drummer was walking out. He quit the band.
Right.
So it went from, oh, you're going to tour with us to, well, we're going to take you on as a trial basis and see what happens. And then 3 days into the tour, they're like, we want you to stay full time if you want it. So that was cool. So after bombing around with them for a year and a half, and we did the Warped Tour in 2015. I took my leave of absence because tempers were a little high and I wasn't super happy with how things were going. And I started another band called To The City. And To The City was basically marketed as featuring Warped Tour alumni.
Right.
Band did pretty well coming out of the gate. And then things started to fall apart, and I got tired of it. So I had a friend, one of my buddies that I used to be in a cover band with, had moved to Florida. He moved to West Palm Beach originally. And when he got to St. Petersburg, which is where he lives now, he was like, dude, St. Pete's amazing. You need to just come down and hang out for a few days and check it out. And I was like, all right. So I flew down. And I left, and then I came back down almost immediately. And I started flying down pretty frequently. And then it got to a point where it was just like, if you're going to stay with me one more day, you're at least paying the electric bill. And he was like, you really should just move here. What's stopping you? And me and my long-term girlfriend of 5 years broke up, and I quit the band, and I really had no reason not to. And the music scene down here is amazing.
Yeah, I mean, that's what a lot of people have been saying. That Florida, I mean, if you're trying to do live music, Florida is the place to be right now with, you know, pandemic-wise.
Oh,
you know?
Yeah. Yeah, and I mean, obviously, like, you got to be responsible about it. Like, the few places I've played, I'm for the most part able to stay detached from people, which is nice. So,
right, that's good.
The one place that I play a lot, it's called Three Daughters Brewery. I load in from the side of the warehouse and right onto the stage. I don't have to talk to anybody. I don't have to be around anybody, really. I always wear a mask. You know, I'm super paranoid about it. And, Yeah. So it's, if you're responsible and you're in a place where, you know, you can be a little bit more choosy about your gigs, then you're pretty good. I know a lot of musicians around here that they don't give a shit and they just play anywhere.
Right.
Which that's not what I'm down with right now. So I'll take a lot of gigs, and there's one in particular this month that I'm not really looking forward to, but when it comes down to it, like, everybody really needs to do their part, and I think that that's not happening enough, and it's damn sure not happening down here with the way things are going and our moron of a governor, but I don't want to get too political. So it's just trying to keep my head above water. I've been very fortunate that I've been able to figure out how to maintain a career as a musician through all of this, because we did have points when we were closed. When March hit and everything happened, like, whole state got shut down, and I lost all of my students. I lost the school that I was teaching at, and I lost all my gigs all at once. And I was gigging 3 to 5 times a week. So just wear bubble just wrap. Wear bubble. Yeah, okay.
Be a bubble boy.
You know how hot that would be? Dear right. God.
Especially in Florida. Jeez.
Dude, playing on stage. Like, if you don't have, I have an air, do you know what an air mover is?
I believe so, yeah.
It's like the industrial, like, floor dryer things.
Right.
So, I have those, that's what I bring with me to gigs, that I set up next to me, because, like, I've played gigs where I felt like I was gonna pass out before it was so hot.
I believe it.
And I'm doing this for, you know, 4 hours. So, that looked like I was jerking two dudes off, yeah. I'm sorry.
It's okay, we're live, we can cut things out, right? You can cut things out when you're live,
you know. So that's basically been it. I over the past 6 months, I restarted my music business, my teaching business, and the whole time I've been down here, well, a good chunk of the time I've been down here, it's been it'll be 3 years in March, I started working with this other band called Nightbreakers, and I've been managing them, and they've been doing really good. And I'll send you some of their stuff so you can check it out. But If you have time, look up Nightbreakers. The last single they put out was called, why am I drawing a blank on it all of a sudden? Pressure. They're going to hate me for that if they're watching this. Sorry, guys.
Especially if Matthew says, that's not how you play drums.
That's how I play drums, Matthew. So,
yeah, I had something.
Yeah, that's been basically it.
Yeah, and you said we were talking earlier that you started to manage a couple bands, correct?
Yeah.
So when did do you have a company name for that, or?
So I'm going under Flying Fox Artist Management now, because I am terrible coming up with names and I like Star Fox.
So that was my next thing, is how the name come about. So there you go. Yeah.
I was trying to figure it out, and I was like, what the hell do I name this company if I'm going to start? Because there's another band I managed to called Mac that we'll be announcing that soon, but I'm not
right
public about that yet. Mm-hmm. But I was like, I need some sort of banner. What do I do? And I was just like, I like Star Fox, so Flying Fox, I guess. And then I went on Fiverr and found somebody to make me a logo, and it actually turned out really good. So
there you go, yeah. So yeah. How long has the, how long have you been doing the management company for?
So I was kicking it around for a little while before I, like, really made a move. It's been a little over a year now. It was, I think August was a year.
Okay.
So I guess about a year and a half. I was basically, like, I had been kicking it around. I wasn't sure if I was going to do it. And this guy I know around here named Jim Chambers, who owns a music school, me and him got to be friends. And he, the guitar player, had been taking lessons there for, like, ever. He still does. And he said, hey, I know this band that's, like, they're ready to go. They just need somebody to kind of kick them in the ass and tell them which direction to take and how they should be, like, putting their band together, or how they should be pushing forward.
Right.
I know you had kind of briefly said that you were thinking about managing bands. I think you should have a conversation. And I was like, oh, yeah, all right, cool, whatever. So I went and played the last Warped Tour in Atlantic City with my roommate, who's the singer for a band called Stack Like Pancakes. And we were driving back, and I was like, oh, yeah, shit, I'm supposed to listen to that band, whatever. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, you know, being a musician, people are always like, listen to my friend's band. You got to listen to my friend's band.
Yeah.
So I was like, all right.
I feel bad when I don't get a chance to actually do that. But, you know, it's like, I don't get it often. But then when I do, it's like, okay, let me just try to at least get a little bit. Then I can, you know, give my honest opinion or just say, you know, but then I don't get it too much. But, you know, it's cool to kind of see when you have people like, oh, I mean, they think that, like, you're not necessarily, like, up at a higher level than them, but, like, oh, you, like, I appreciate you doing this music. Hey, my friend is, like, in a band or he has music. You should check it out and stuff like that. So
as soon as people found out I was signed, it was, like, fucking floodgates opened up. Like, I had people I hadn't talked to in years, like, oh, it's cool that you signed a record deal. So, you should really listen to my cousin. He plays guitar, and I'm just like, what do I do with that? Like, no.
Right.
It's not that I'm not up for helping people. I love helping people.
Exactly.
But,
yeah.
You know, just saying like, oh, so-and-so is a drummer. What can he do? It's like, go find a band and then talk to me. Like,
yeah, exactly.
And I'm not an A&R guy either. It's not like I'm just going to go to a label and be like, here, this band.
Right.
So, I started working with them, and things have been going pretty good. I've been pretty happy with how things are going for the most part.
Yeah, it seems like you've been keeping busy. It's good to know that. So on that segment, how about we get you to play one of the first songs of the night?
Oh, Lord. all right. Let's do it. What I want to play. I actually have my iPad off to the side here so I can cheat.
Mm-hmm. It's okay to cheat every once in a while, people.
That's right, it is. How about let's play Name That Song. So I'm gonna play a song, you have to tell me what song it is.
This is either gonna be good or bad, people.
He's talking about my performance, he'll know the song.
If you pull out a lesser known hero song, then this stream is gonna be really funny.
Oh, dude!
I was gonna tell you to do one.
I can't even remember how many of them go.
I don't remember either. I'd have to even like look in our discography.
I do remember one. Hold on.
And
I play drums in this band, but I think I know how this goes.
All I remember is okay, yeah. There you go.
I don't remember the rest.
I don't remember the words, but yeah, that was the main riff. That's cool. I'm glad. That's awesome that you still remember that riff.
I can't believe I just remembered that. I haven't even tried to play that in like a decade, so.
I'm gonna have to try to search the internet to see if that song is still up on the internet somewhere.
I still have it in my. I'll find it and I'll send it to you because I still have it in my iTunes somewhere.
Yeah, you definitely need.
Oh Lord, yeah, I'll definitely.
I would love.
It's on my it's on my external hard drive, which I think is plugged in. Yeah, it is plugged in. So, All right.
So let's get to your guest spot, and this is Kevin Sitaras. You're gonna play an original cover.
It's gonna be a cover.
All right, then we're gonna do a cover for.
Oh yeah, hi friends. There we go.
Must have been me. Many questions like you. sipping late afternoon on a way the sun broke free of the clouds. We count only blue cars in the sneakers in the street. We ask many questions like children often do. He said, tell me your thoughts on God, 'cause I'd really like to meet her and ask her why we're who we are. Oh, tell me I'm on my way to see her and tell me, am I very far? Am I very far now? It's getting cold, pick up the pace. Our shoes make hard noises in this place. Our clothes are stained. We pass many cross-eyed people and ask many questions like children often do. He said, tell me I'd really like to meet her and ask her why we're who we are. Oh, tell me all your thoughts on God, 'cause I'm on my way to see her and tell me, am I very far?
Round of applause from Mr. Sitaras.
That's right.
Great song, says Anthony.
Oh,
thank
wait,
you,
hold
Anthony.
On my headphones off. Don't talk. I couldn't hear myself. I had to take my in-ears out.
It's all good. Yeah, thank
so,
you for watching.
So, what song
Anthony.
Was it?
Tell me all your thoughts on God. I'm not sure if that's the actual song name, but what was the band? It's a 90s tune. But I forget. Is it it's not Vertical Horizon, is it? I'm going to have to check it out. I know the song.
Dishwalla.
Dishwalla, there you go. Yeah.
Counting Blue Cars.
There you go. Yeah. I know it was because it was like Dishwalla, I think like Tonic and then
Vertical Horizon all sounded
Vertical
the
Horizon.
Same.
They all kind of sounded in that like kind of that sound, that 90s rock sound. So like you never knew which which band
which
that actually
one it was.
Yeah, exactly.
So when are you going to do a song, sir?
I'm going to get a song in a little bit. I want to know, how you felt about, being on Warped Tour. So let's talk a little bit about, your memories of Warped Tour. Because you played on the last Warped Tour, so that had to been something to kind of put on your resume.
Oh, yeah, for sure. So... You want to talk about 2015 or just the last one?
Let's do the last one since I guess that's the most historical one with being the last Warped Tour ever.
All right, so I Let me circle back a little bit. I want to wind the clocks back. So back in November, October, I think, the summer before, some stuff happened that I won't get into. You can read about it, with Stack Like Pancakes. And Kellen, the singer, called me and said, or no, I called him and I just kind of offered support and said, I know that these things can be tough. If you need anything, call me. And that wasn't a me like saying, oh, I'll be your drummer. It was just like legit. If you want to just talk about it, because when you get crucified for being a businessman, it kind of sucks, and it's just how things go sometimes. He said, oh, thanks, I appreciate it. I'll keep you in touch. And like we met on Warped Tour in 2015. We were on the same stage, but it wasn't like we were close friends or anything. We just knew each other. So, he hit me up a few days later and was like, so really random, you live in Florida now, right? And I said, yeah. And he goes, are you coming home for Thanksgiving? And I said, yeah, I planned on it. Why? And he goes, well, I have a show on Black Friday. Was it Friday or Saturday? I think it was on Friday. He was like, I have a show. Or no, it was on Saturday. My bad. Because we rehearsed on Friday. He was like, I have a show Saturday, that weekend. Would you be able to do it? And I was like, well, my drums are down here in Florida with me, but I guess I could borrow my dad's kit. My dad's a drummer, which is the kit I used to bring to the Lesser Known Heroes practices. I was like, yeah, I can borrow my dad's kit, I guess. What's going on? And there's no other drummers around. He's like, oh, I just, I know you're a good drummer. I'd like to play with you. I was like, all right, cool. Send me a set list. So he sent me a set list and I learned everything. We had one day to rehearse all this stuff, and I had clicks in my ears that changed tempos during songs, and I had like one rehearsal to get them right. So I was like
No pressure at
freaking out a
all.
little. Yeah, right, exactly. I was just like, this could be really bad. And it wasn't just me too, like the whole band was new. So it wasn't just like, okay, so drummer needs to learn songs, everybody else fall into place. It was like, no, the whole band got replaced. And we were all equally shitting our pants because, we had one rehearsal to get on stage and play tight, which, I mean, anybody that's a musician knows it's not easy to do. So we did our one rehearsal and we're like, well, that's as good as it's gonna get. And it was good. I mean, we weren't sad about how we sounded. And then we went and played the show and we killed it. And we all got off stage. We're like, how the hell do we pull that one off? I think
Yeah,
we collectively
I
were
got the
all.
catch you guys said, and you guys sounded pretty tight to me.
Oh, you're talking about Warped?
Yeah, from the Warped Tour set that I saw you at, yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah, so
So yeah,
after this show.
the first time you guys played, but yeah, and then I guess you guys had a little bit more time to kind of coordinate stuff, but yeah, you guys definitely sounded really well at Warped.
We have one rehearsal for that too.
Well, you guys are good at just doing one little practice and just get going at it.
Yeah, well, I mean, and that's why preparation's important.
Yeah.
If you listen to, like, me and the bass player got to be pretty good buddies, Nick, and like we had some conversations because like drummers and bass players need to be tight. And our conversations were basically like, are you learning these recordings note for note? Every little accent, every fill, yes, okay, then we'll be fine. Like if you leave as little up to interpretation as possible and just say, I want to play all of these parts, every little nuance of this part, I'm going to play. Then when you get together, I mean, you should be fairly okay.
Right.
And that's what happened. Like we practiced a lot on our own, we talked a lot. There are parts of songs that occasionally, like, I would hear or he would hear, and we text each other about it and be like, oh, make sure that you get this little accent here. Are you focusing on this part? Whatever. Just to be sure, because I mean, even though you can say learn something note for note, you might not pick up everything that I pick up, and then there's things that I might that you pick up that I don't. So it's nice to have those conversations when you don't have time to rehearse to at least talk about those things. So we rehearsed once for Warped, and then yeah, we did that. So after that gig, me and Kellen started to like be tighter friends, and we talk occasionally. And he hit me up. I remember I was working as the last restaurant I worked at. I was waiting tables, just a few shifts a week. And it was February, and he called me, and he was just like, are you free over the summer to play Warped Tour? And I was like, what? Yeah. And he said, do you want to, because it's the last one, and I just got asked to do it, and I want to do it with you. And I was like, fuck yeah. So,
right. I mean, you get an opportunity to play Warped, you really can't turn that down.
Right. And at that point, me and him had some conversations, and he had decided to move down here. So, cause he was living in Baltimore, and he was like going through a lot of stuff. And I had said, you know, is there a reason why you live in Baltimore? Like, you have to be there. And he was like, no. And I said, well then, why don't you move to Florida? I have a 4-bedroom house. Cause I did at that time.
Right.
I'll rent you a room and a bathroom cheap, and you can come here and hang out, and you know, we'll do whatever. So he was like, oh, thanks for the offer. Probably not. And I said, all right. And then he called me like 2 days later. He's like, were you serious? And I said, yeah. And he's like, all right, I'm coming down April 1st. I'm like, see you then.
Here we go.
And he just showed up April 1st with a U-Haul. See you next week. Yep. So, so he called me February. I saw him to do it. I said, yeah, absolutely. He sent me a set list, and I started working on it. And then we had one other gig in April that we played the Launch Music Conference.
Okay.
That April, I think it was April.
Yeah, it's usually in April.
Yeah, and then we came back, and me and him talked a little bit about some stuff. Me and him, he plays guitar for a few songs in Saints. So and because we were playing a few new songs that were on his new record that like none of us had rehearsed before.
Right.
I had said, if there's any point when you want to like sit down and talk to me about some of these parts of the songs that, you know, give me a leg up. And he was like, yeah, absolutely. Cause like everybody needs to know the songs obviously, but being a drummer and having a click track in your ear with the actual tracks and the tempos, cause some of his tempos move around a little bit. Like all that stuff is super stressful as it is, you know, and to have one rehearsal and make mental notes of all the little things that somebody tells you, to then get on stage and play in front of 2,000 people is a little intimidating.
Yeah,
so,
true. Yeah, I can imagine.
Yeah, and then on top of that, they decided to switch the DAW that we use live. So we were using Logic in rehearsals, and that morning when we got to Warped and like set up and sound check, they decided to load everything into Ableton.
Run
Ableton, which I don't know why it mattered, and I was the one that had to run the whole thing, and I had never used Ableton before. So I'm in front of 2,000 people hoping to God that I can like get the tracks to work.
Exactly.
Because I had no idea how to use, for those that aren't listening and don't know, a DAW is a recording program. So Logic, Pro Tools, Ableton, all those are DAWs.
Again, no pressure at all.
Yeah. Right, exactly. It was like, I don't have enough to worry about right now. So
You're only the drummer. Yeah. You only keep the rhythm of the full band.
And there's a point in one of the songs where the track stops, and he goes out into the audience and gets up, or like has people hold up his legs, and he stands up in the audience, and I have to like wait for him to be in position before I can start the track again.
Uh-huh.
So when that part came, I was like having an anxiety attack because I'm like looking over the computer like, please God, work right. I only have one shot at this, you know, and I hit space bar and I waited, and then I heard 1, 2, 3, 4. I'm like, oh, Jesus Christ. Thank
right.
You. So all these people are holding them up and supporting, and I'm like, please God, let this track work. Please.
Just let the track work. And
yeah. So
it's not like you can really just turn back and be like, oh wait, guys, I got to restart this computer. I know there's like a lot of people waiting. I know we have a certain time limit, but you guys will be fine. Don't worry about it.
So that happened at launch. So at launch, his computer started updating for whatever reason right before we were going on stage. So it was like 30 seconds before we were supposed to start playing that the computer loaded up and I had Logic in front of me. And I was like, oh, thank God. And then we weren't getting any sound out of the computer. And I didn't know why. I couldn't hear the click. And would you like to know why? It's because I didn't plug my headphones in because I'm an idiot.
Oh, yeah. And yeah. So, when did you necessarily figure out that you didn't have it plugged in?
Oh, it was a solid 5 minutes that I was on stage trying to figure it out.
And it's always the simplest things. They're like, oh, I didn't plug my headphones in. It's not that the computer's not working. It's like, oh, I just didn't do the simplest thing that I should have done first.
Dude, and I almost always, because I've done that so many times with dumb shit like that, I almost always look at that stuff first
Right.
Because it's always like, I know this is the stupid thing, but that's probably what it is. And mm-hmm. if I would have just picked up my headphone thing like this, I would have felt the weight and felt that it wasn't connected to something.
And nine times out of ten, that I mean, the simplest things are what's wrong with half the things. Even when I'm like live, I'll have little, you know, small glitches come up. Because I think I had a show back in October, and I hadn't like set up my rig in about 8 months. So it took me, you know, a little bit to get back in my rhythm, because I was playing at least like 2-3 shows a month. So I had it down packed, like, okay, walk in, load in, put this on the floor, get this, you know, plugged in, turn this on, I'm ready to go. But then, you know, once you're out of that rhythm, it's like, okay, I put this on the floor, right? This cable goes to that cable. This, what the hell is this cable? I think that goes there. And then, so that I turn the thing on, it's like, I'm like, okay, something's wrong. So it took me like another like 10-15 minutes to figure out what the connection issue was. And plus, I during the pandemic, I had upgraded a lot of my, you know, live rig gear. So it was the first time playing out with, you know, this new mic and a whole brand new pedal board and everything and all the glitz and glam of that. So, you know, for people, if they were seeing my social media this week, I have a gig coming up this weekend. So, you know, I'm hoping, you know, I've been trying to prep everything to kind of be ready so I don't have that thing happen to me again. But at least this time I'll know, okay, either this has to come in a little too hot, I can turn that down or this down, because usually it goes right through a mixer before it hits my PA. So there's certain things that I can, you know, adjust before it hits the PA. But yeah, just knowing certain things that, like, you know, the simplest things, and you're like, okay, start with the simplest things and then work your way out to, like, okay, it could be like, you know, a guitar glitch or some type of cable thing, but oh, you could just not be plugged in.
Yeah. So so played Warped, I survived it, and actually, funny postscript to that launch story. So we were under the impression we were playing, I guess, Sunday, I think, and it was Saturday, and my girlfriend at the time said, oh, have a good show, and I was just like, well, man, I'm just watching. She's like, no, you guys are playing in like an hour, aren't you? And I was like, what? And then I looked at the schedule, and I was like, Kellen, we're playing today. And he's like, what? We didn't know. And like, all of a sudden, the group text started blowing up because all of us were like,
"This is my buddy David Earl. He's saying don't act, he's saying this to me. Don't act like you know PA and sound." I don't. I just know to plug in and it just makes sound, and I just know how to make sound. And you know, I'm just that type of kid that's just like, oh, I know how to make noise, just like that the commercial. Like I push things up and put them down, like the Planet Fitness commercial. I pick things up and put them down. Like I plug things in and make sounds.
That's right. That's all it is. That's why we hire sound guys. We don't want to know about that shit.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Other than that, it was cool. I met some people. I met Mark Hoppus, kind of. I was like walking through the hallway to go to catering, and he was standing outside, and I was just like, oh, hey, you just saw my old producer, Bruce. He was like, oh, yeah. I was like, yeah, can I get a picture? He was like, sure. I was like, all right. And like, I never take pictures with people because, like, I try not to, like fangirl over people, and I'm not, like, the biggest Blink-182 fan anyway. But at the time, I was running a rock school program at a conservatory, and I was already telling my students, like, oh, yeah, I'm going to go play Warped this summer and blah, 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 and they all hated me. So when I got the picture with Mark, I like sent it in our group text with all my kids, and I was just like, ah, they're like, we hate you. How'd you meet him? Somebody was just like, that looks like a grandfather. Who's that? I was like, it's Mark Hoppus.
It's Mark Hoppus, only the most famous Blink-182 person. Like, well, who's right. He?
Yeah. And I'm just like, you know, we played one of their songs this year, right? Like, that's what you were playing on bass, was that guy.
Exactly. And so my buddy Dave, he was saying what band is was Kevin from. So
Rolling Stones,
yeah, this weird band. They kind of just deformed. They had this old guitar player that just is like still lingering around. But no, Dave, Kevin played the last Warped Tour, and the name of the band you played for was what, Kevin?
Stack Like Pancakes.
Stack Like Pancakes. So what was the stage that you played on? I forget the stage.
Oh God, I don't,
either of us remember.
Blackcraft, I think.
It was one of the furthest walks. You know, you had the main stage, and then like the bigger the smaller two stages that were like way further back, like near the entrance, the back entrance.
Thanks for downplaying my achievements, bud.
Not even the fact that, hey, either all the stage, I mean, the main stage was the biggest one, but even the smaller stages.
He was on that small shit stage that was right by the entrance, but not on the side where you enter in. It was on the other side of the entrance where, you know, they try to draw you in, and that's why nobody came.
They just had people walking by like, pancakes? What are pancakes? I mean, oh, well, I'm hungry. Let's get pancakes.
Right? Dude, I haven't eaten dinner yet, and I want pancakes now, and I'm on this, like, fat kid diet that I don't want to be on. It sucks.
I mean, everybody's on that type of diet every once in a while. So.
Yeah, I know. I'm not now, but I was heavier than I had ever been. And, I've always kind of struggled with weight issues, but I have a pretty good metabolism. I just eat like shit and entirely too much. So, when it creeps up on me, I usually like chill out, but I can usually drop weight pretty easy. It's just, I don't ever do it.
And especially since we're older, you know, you start to really realize now, especially me now, like that you can't lose weight as fast as you used to when you were like in your 20s. And you're like,
yeah.
So now I'm in that predicament right now where I'm like, oh, crap, I definitely need to lose weight right now. But it's like, this weight used to go off a lot quicker than I remember. So now I'm like, crap, I actually have to work at this now.
Dude, I used to drop 20 pounds in a month, like the first month gone.
Right.
You know, I am down 10 pounds in about 10 days, though. So I am doing pretty good.
Hey, that's good. You know, a pound a day, that's saying something.
Yeah, I mean, I was 245 when I started, and I'm like 235 now.
There you go. So, hey, a loss is a loss.
Yeah, and I mean, like, my whole diet has changed, and I just started going back to the gym yesterday, actually, so, like, I'm a little sore today. But yeah. I mean...
The soreness, yeah, the day after. I haven't been to the gym in a while, and especially with everything going on.
You were going hard for a while.
I was, and, you know, it just, you know, I think especially with me starting to play a lot more shows, it kind of just took more priority with, you know, being able to play shows, and, you know, I had already injured myself, like, once or twice in the gym, so I'm like, all right, well, I don't need to be injuring myself, and then I'm out of playing shows for a little while. So, you know, I started, you know, putting more priority into playing more shows, and then the gym nights, because I was going like 5 nights a week.
Yeah.
And at least like probably 2 hours a night right after work. So,
dude, I never understand how people can go to the gym that long. Like, I'm in and out of the gym in an hour most of the time. Like, I'll go when I get like into hardcore gym mode. I cut my diet down to 1500 calories a day, and I'm in the gym like at least 5 days a week, but usually six. Right. And like, I'm going to go, I have a gym in my apartment complex, thank God. So I'm going to go when I get off here. Mm-hmm. But like, I still, for the life of me, I'm like, how the hell do you stay there for 2 hours? Like, what do you do?
Well, I was, you know, following a program at the time, and, you know, I usually like when I was doing a lot of my workouts, I don't like to, you know, run and do them as quick as I can. I usually try to, you know, take my time, and, you know, at that time when I was like trying to, you know, really focus on, you know, working the specific muscle group that I was like working with, instead of just, you know, pushing weight, because anybody can just push weight, but knowing, you know, okay, if you're doing like a bench press, like feeling what muscles need to actually be contracting at that certain time, or if you're doing a back exercise, making sure that, you know, you're feeling the certain muscles in that muscle group working, instead of just being like, oh, okay, I can lift 50 pounds, and, you know, but you're not actually, you know, feeling the actual specific muscle group that you're doing, because then you're necessarily having other muscles compensate for that specific muscle group. So it's like, you know, trying to have that mind to muscle connection. That always kind of made me like take the time to really concentrate on every single exercise. So, you know, and then, like you said, once you get into that mode, then you don't even think about the time. You're in there at 6. Next thing you know, it's like 8 o'clock at night. You're like, okay, well, I got to get home because I got to get ready for work the next day. So,
yeah. Usually when I, like, I never go to like bulk. Like you were trying to bulk up a little bit, right?
A little bit. I was trying. You know, I was doing a little bit of it during, you know, the fall winter months, and then once around this time would start, then I would start cutting down for the summer. Sometimes it would work, sometimes it wouldn't.
Yeah, whenever I've gone, like I don't care about being big at all. It's always just been about like losing weight and be like maintaining and being fit and stuff.
Yeah.
So like when I do weight training, it's always it's more about the cardio and the my headphone cable here. It's more about the cardio and the
right.
Just general getting my body moving than it is about specifically like building certain groups. So I still do concentrate. Like as I'm doing it, I focus, you know, on my biceps and tries and whatever.
Uh-huh.
But it's nice when you're not working for gains that you can be a little bit more lax about how you work out, because you're really just keeping your body moving in different ways. So you're burning calories more than anything.
And once you get into like the specifics of like how I was just saying, like my muscle connection and everything. And it's once you get into like the, you know, details of like how your body actually really works, it actually keeps you more inspired to be knowing more about how your body functions, and especially with the nutrition side and knowing, like, you know, not necessarily what to eat, but like what you're eating is fueling for that workout, and then what you're eating after is fueling for that next workout, and not necessarily making food as like, you know, food is like necessarily the fuel for that workout, if you're thinking of that. And, you know, the fact that like everybody is like all about like, oh, carbs are the enemy and everything, but like if you think of carbs as your fuel source, then it's a totally different aspect of what you're doing. And you know, it's I used to be more you know, into like the fitness industry and everything, and but you know, it's just like music, it's like a cutthroat type of, you know, business that, you know, you have to have that look and have that specific you know, title or something to kind of just make a name for yourself. But you know, there's all these influencers out there that want to just you know, be the next it person. So
yeah, you gonna play me something?
Yeah, I'm gonna play you something. Yeah. And I'm gonna play the lovely audience something. I'm gonna actually try to redeem myself on this one, because I was gonna try to play this song the first time for the last show when I was with John Taylor. So I actually remember the lyric, the first lyric that I did. So I'm gonna play that song right now, and this is the first song that I wrote, but not the first song that I recorded for Spoken Life. So and this was actually re-recorded for my my EP Reality. So if you guys have heard this song, thank you all for who have listened to this. And if you haven't, you know, you guys can check this out on, you know, Spotify, Apple Music, everything where you can stream music. So this song is called Remember.
What do you say we come back home and start over? 'Cause it seems like yesterday we had it all figured out, but now you're gone and you're not coming back. Let me go to my spotlights. Days have passed and months have gone by since the last time I've seen your face. I never thought a love like this could fade. The summer breeze and the memories of us together were bittersweet. I never thought that this is how things could be, but that was then. This is now, and I can see that we're going down. We're going down, so please remember me for the man that I've become. I know we've gone our separate ways, and things were left unsaid. Since now, you've gone away and left me in misery. I know there's not much left to say, but trust me, you're not alone. not alone now. The pictures I kept were just not enough to keep my mind at ease through these times of desperate needs. I need you now more than ever, 'cause I can't go on like this forever. That was then, and this is now, and I can see that we're going down. We're going down, so please remember me for the man that I've become. I know we've gone our separate ways, and things were left unsaid. Since now, you've gone away and left me in misery. I know there's not much left to say. Trust me, you're not alone. You're not alone now. Do to see you smile again, I'd give my everything, and I give my all. Please remember me for the man that I've become. I know we've gone our separate ways, and things were left unsaid. Since now, you've gone away and left me in misery. I know there's not much left to say, but trust me, you're not alone. You're not alone now.
Woo! Standing ovation, everybody. Thank you.
Show.
I wonder if you can just wonder if you can harmonize claps. Like, that would be funny,
dude. I'll make it happen. I'll put him in the Melodyne and I'll just pitch him up and down.
Right.
That was so good. Oh my god.
Oh my god. Oh my god. It's my best song. Thanks, Dave. Appreciate it. Oh, Dave didn't, you know, because Dave was on last time, and when we were on the last stream, then my stream ended up going, you know, berserk. So, Dave, you're actually doing good for me tonight. Thank you. I really appreciate it. I'm glad you're here, buddy. So, Kev, do you have anything specific that you're working on right now musically that... you know, people can be looking forward to in the next couple months, or are you kind of just, you know, going with the motions and, you know, kind of keeping it under wraps for people?
So, I will announce something. You know what? Why not? This is something.
Oh,
that
we got
I've
breaking
been,
news.
I've been keeping down.
Yes.
All right, smartass. So. I wanted to abandon the other two concepts that I had a while ago and start a new one. I actually registered the social media for it already, but I haven't actually told anybody, and there's nothing on any of it, so don't even bother looking for it right now. So I decided I want to go in and record a few new singles for myself, and it's probably going to be sometime around the summer that I'll be releasing them. It's going to be under the banner Light Up Your Eyes, or Light Up Their Eyes, sorry. That's about it. So I have a few songs that are written for it already. I'm buying a house in April, so I got to deal with all that ridiculousness, as you know, since having gone through it.
Thankfully, it wasn't too hard because we had a really great, realtor. We had, you know, some crazy ones before actually, you know, sticking with the one that we had for this house. But, you know, if you have somebody that doesn't necessarily not know what they're doing, but if they you know, have all their P's and Q's, dotting their I's, crossing their T's and everything ready to go for you, it's a smooth ride. And especially the people on the other side, they were really nice to kind of show us the house prior. And, you know, the guy was able to come in and, you know, show me, you know, hey, this electrical outlet is working with this one, and, you know, showing me like the ins and outs of the house before actually, you know, transferring everything. So they were really nice with the transfer and everything to him.
That's cool. So yeah, so I'm in the process of dealing with all that ridiculousness. And, I mean, I have a full on recording rig, so I mean, it's not like I can't do it or I don't really have any excuse.
Right.
It's been something I've been wanting to do for a while. And I told myself I was going to release music last year, and then just like, the pandemic basically ruined that. It became a financial issue more than anything, because right. with the pandemic, it was like all of my money was gone. It got to the point where, oddly enough, I was working from home for Florida State Unemployment as like one of their call center reps. So, right. and I did that for like a month and I hated it. And
I was just going to say that had to been horrible.
Oh, dude, it was shitty.
I can imagine the phone calls with that, just because, I mean, it's, I mean, you got to do what you got to do, but you're always going to have those people like, why are you taking so long? I don't know, because there's probably a million people that are on unemployment right now.
Well, the worst thing, there was 3 million. The worst thing was, so just to give you an example of like how ridiculous this affected, like the pandemic affected employment. And I say this to everybody, and this is not political. This is just how things went. And being the fact that I was working for this organization, I can say this 100% that this is accurate. So normally, most years they said that they have about 175,000 calls that they handle a year, and maybe 100-125,000 claims, somewhere around that ballpark. Right. The first weekend that it was announced that the unemployment thing was happening and that, all these people that were laid off were able to register for unemployment, we had 3 million phone calls.
Wow.
In one weekend.
Jeez.
And normally there's 175,000 that happen in an entire year. So just to put it in perspective of like how crazy it got,
right.
And why like everything got shut down is because like nobody was prepared for it. So what was going on was, while I was working there, the governor was trying to figure out what to do on top of everything. And mm-hmm. we all had to wait for instructions from him as to how to handle anything. So people were calling and asking questions, and we had no answers because we weren't given any, because he didn't know what to do himself. And I'm not like blaming him for it. I'm just right. saying it was a mess. So, so that what made it hard was having people call me and be like, I got to pay my rent. What do I do? I don't have an answer for you, you know, and there's nothing I could tell them. The only thing legit, the only thing I could do was reset people's passwords. That was it. So if they were trying to log into the website, which was basically always down because they kept getting too much traffic, if they were trying to log into the website and they're having issues because they didn't have a password, then I could reset their password. And that right. was all. So people call me like, well, what do you know about this and this and this? And I'm like, nothing. Not a thing. So,
and it's nothing you can do, you know, but
there's nothing I can do.
But that's
I will
your
say
fault.
This. Yeah. Once things, once they trained us a little bit better, because I was brought on by Attempt Service, once they trained us a little bit better, and we finally started to get some answers, I was able to give people a whole lot of money all at once, which was kind of fun because it was retroactive. So I'd get people that call. They're like, I filed a claim back in April. It's July. What can I do? You know, or I filed a claim a month ago and I was like, well, how long have you been unemployed? And they're like, since April. And I was like, okay, well, then I can give you $8,000. They're like, what? So
okay,
out
thanks.
Of nowhere that. Right. They go from like, I don't know how I'm going to eat, to like, you'll have a check for $8,000 deposited in the next like 2 weeks. Have fun. So that was fun. That was nice. Once I could start doing that stuff for people, it was really
great. Hey, Sabrina. Thanks for joining us. Appreciate it.
Hi, Sabrina. I don't know you.
Thanks for joining us, Sabrina.
So yeah, as far as that goes, that was, it was terrible at first, then it was okay. Yeah, like musically, that's really the only thing that's going on is, I'm on the DL writing for this project now. Hopefully I'll have something out over the summer. It's going
to
depend on
we'll be
on
looking
too,
forward
like,
to it. You know, I mean, you know, good things take time, but you know, it's one thing that sometimes you don't always, you know, you can, especially when you're doing your own recording, writing and recording, you know, at least you don't have to feel pressured to be like, okay, I got to get this done by a certain time because I'm on like a time crunch. Right. And plus, like if I wait any longer, I'm going to have to pay more money. And then if I pay more money, I'm not going to have the money for, so at least, especially doing your own recordings, you can take your time with it and, you know, mold everything to what you want to.
Right. And this house that I'm buying, I already have two friends. I have two of my best friends are brothers, and one's a contractor kind of guy, and the other guy's an audio engineer. So I was like, I'll fly you both down here, pay you each $1,000 a week, and I'll take you to Disney if you build me a studio in my garage. And they're like, okay.
Yeah.
So once, one of my first priorities when I get in the house is to get that done. So I'll be in the house in April. I'll probably have that done by like middle of May. And as soon as I have that, then I'll have everything wired up and set up so I can record whatever I want. And I'll probably be cooking pretty good then. Like, my goal is to put out singles, but it's entirely possible that I'm just going to record a whole album. So it's just going to depend on how I'm feeling and what I want to do. Cause I am going to do it all myself. Like I've done a lot of recording on my own before, you know, I've like multi-layered everything and played drums and guitar and sound, whatever. But it's always been like, I've gone into a studio and done it, or I did it as pre-production, not as actual production.
Yeah.
So I've also been thinking about doing it as like, oh, I'll pre-produce, you know, whatever I want to do in my studio and get as good as I can, like in terms of sounds, and then go into a real studio and be like, these are my like legit demos.
Right.
You know, let's work off of those.
Yeah. And that's something that I've been really trying to learn is to, you know, be improving my recording and mixing and mastering skills. And, you know,
it takes a long time, man.
It does. It's something that, you know, that you just don't go on and just start tweaking stuff. It's just not something that just comes. It takes practice. Like, and they always say, like, you know, never stick to one song and, you know, just move to the next song, start mixing that, take another song, mix that, because every song's different. You'll find something different with every single one. And if you keep on mixing and trying to learn on one song, it's never gonna work.
Yeah, I mean, even something as simple as like learning your reverbs and your compressions and stuff like that.
Exactly.
You know, that took me a while to like really understand like what's practical where, and you know,
yeah,
like understanding that like there are different kinds of reverbs for a reason. Don't just use the same one on everything. I fall into that trap all the time of like, I go on Logic, I'm like, Space Designer, click. All right, that's my reverb.
Exactly.
You know, instead of like going through and listening to like the different kinds of delays and stuff I can use instead, and, you know.
And I've learned the fact that with recording, you know, it's not the same thing as, you know, playing live. That, you know, like, oh, if you're being, you know, that we both play guitar, you know, if you go on stage, you're like, okay, let me turn up to 11. But you do that on a recording, it's going to sound like crap. So you have to kind of level match everything. And that was something that, you know, and especially with tone, guitar tones on a recording sometimes are not the same as what you would do on a live thing, because it has to, you know, mix everything with like the drums and the vocals, and especially that's where EQ comes in, where, you know, you have to find where everything is like kind of necessarily having their own space, and then learning to, you know, make room for, you know, dipping, you know, an EQ out for in the guitars that where the vocals may sit, so you can give that headroom for them to poke out, and where the drums might be sitting for the bass, you know, you want to either cut
them
or
mids,
sweep,
baby.
So cutting them mids. And that's something, especially with making the intro to this song, I took a little bit of time mixing that, and I took that advice of like, you know, cutting a lot of the mids. I'm like, wow, this is a lot more clearer than what a lot of my other stuff has been. And like,
yep,
I can hear everything.
All your mud sits, man, is in the mids.
So I clipped out a lot of that, and not too much either. Just like little, like just about like 3 dB of like a little here and there, 3 dB here, and it goes a long way, but it cleared up a lot of, you know, like that wonk 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 kind of sound. I'm like, wow, this, so it kind of lets you like see like, okay, if I can do good on this one, you know, my next one will start being a little bit better, and then the next one will start being a little bit better. So yeah, you know, it's like you said, it's just it takes time, but once it starts clicking, you're like, okay, then especially with compression, you know, like, okay, once you start hearing what the compressor's doing, then you're like, okay, that's what needs to be done. And especially with EQ, like I was so dead set on like, you know, doing like effects and everything, but then just not nearly, you know, putting much attention on what the EQ is doing and or how an EQ works and how a compressor really works. And then just like, I only put it on because you're supposed to put it on, but necessarily not that you may not need either of those because it's good the way it is.
Dude, you know what I'm embarrassed to admit is like, so I just started really mixing drums like in the past 6 months, and I never realized how much of a difference like gain made, like adding gain onto a snare and a kick. As soon as I was trying, I'm like, why aren't these loud enough? Like, what can I do? And it's like, I didn't want to add gain because I didn't want to clip anything.
Right.
And I was like, ah, the hell with it. I'm just going to try it and see what happens. Dude, I added gain and I was like, what the hell? It sounded like a different drum. I'm like, holy shit.
It is,
dude,
yeah.
Like, as soon as I figured that out, I was like gaining everything. I'm like, all right, all this shit's going up.
And, you know, especially with using a lot of you know, we're going to probably get like into like a recording talk here, but you know, going into, you know, using different buses to, instead of doing every track individually, setting that into a bus and then, you know, EQing working and compressing that first. And then if you start hearing little things, then go into your individual tracks, and that kind of saves, you know, CPU power. And then you probably won't have to mix as much if you start with your buses first. And then once you start hearing, you know, little things, then you can go into your individual tracks and kind of, you know, see where that specific problem is if you need to.
Vocal busing and guitar busing has saved me so much time.
Yeah.
Oh my God. I didn't even know. It's funny because before I learned about busing, I was like, I don't get why there's not a thing where you can just group a whole bunch of stuff together and edit them together. It makes no sense. And, like, I remember talking to one of my buddies about it as an engineer. He's like, are you stupid? And I was like, I mean, I imagine it has to exist. He's like, don't you know what a bus is? And I'm like, I mean, I've ridden SEPTA before.
But I was like, you know that? You mean that yellow big thing? That
right.
You mean that yellow school bus we used to ride?
Yeah. So I was like, and he was like, that's exactly what a bus does. And I'm like,
Oh.
All right.
Thanks.
And then it took me a while to figure out, I'm like, why isn't my buses working? I'm like, oh, because I still have like the outs,
the outputs,
the,
it's not going
individually, still running.
Yeah,
so like you can't hear the difference between that and the buses. It's like, oh
yeah, trying
to, how to like
then rerouting everything. I've had that type of thing. So like, why can't I hear anything? Oh, because it's not going into the bus yet, and then it's not going into the stereo out. So oh yeah, dumb me. But
yeah,
the loveliness of music production.
I hate recording. Like, I'm not even going to, like, try to say it has a redeeming quality. I fucking hate recording. Like,
It has, like, a love-hate thing for me. Like, I love trying to, you know, try new things with it, but then, like, when you're not getting what you want out of it, you're like, oh, God, why can't I, like, either get this sound or why... Especially if I'm taking a lot of takes to get, like, one little verse or something, and I'm just not getting it, then I'm like... Okay, like, take 130.
Yeah, dude, the whole reason why I became, like, a good recording drummer is because I hated recording. And I was just like, I would go into studios and take me 2 hours to lay down drums for a song, and I'm like, what the hell? You know, like, what am I doing so wrong? And I listen back to it, I'm like, how do I fix that? And I finally, like, I got so frustrated. I remember growing up, my dad, you know, who's also a drummer, would always tell me, like, you know, work with a metronome, practice with a click, it's important.
I was just going, like, to be saying to you.
Yeah, so I finally, like, I remember coming home from recording one time. I was like, yeah, it took me 2 hours to record a song. My dad's like, what's wrong with you? I'm like, I don't know. You know, and he was just like, when's the last time you played to a click? I'm like, at the studio? And he goes, before that. And I was like, couldn't tell you.
Right.
So, and finally I was like, all right. And I sat for like 6 months almost every single day for a half hour. I sat down with a practice pad and drilled rudiments into me. And then I started, after a few months, I would go and bring it onto a kit. And dude, night and day difference in my playing. And, you know, like, I felt at the time I was that little asshole kid that was like, I don't need that shit.
Yeah.
You know? And now I'm older and I'm like, I'm yelling at my students and I'm like, use a metronome. And they're like, it sucks. And I'm like, I understand that.
And I think when we were in Lesser Known Heroes, I think a lot of the original Sins tracks we did live takes of those and then did vocals on top. So I think it wasn't necessarily individually tracked. When we did the Lesser Known Heroes stuff, I think you were the first one that started saying, hey, you guys need to play to a click. And I'm like, well, what the hell is that? Yeah, and then, right. You know, then that's why it was taking us so long to record, because we never recorded to a click. We were so used to just doing live takes and then just, you know, recording either solos over top of that, vocals and everything. So, like, when, you know, we were being told, like, oh, okay, so we had to go home and practice the songs with a click. So then, you know, we weren't looking like idiots in the studio. So I think I'd have to kind of say that you were the first person to, you know, say like, hey, you need to start recording to a click. So ever since then, it was like, okay, now, you know, whenever I record, it's like recording with a click now.
Yeah. And dude, like, once you're used to it, like, I don't think about it anymore. When I first started playing to a click live, I was like, fuck this. I do not want to do this. And because it killed the vibe for me.
Yeah.
And then once I got used to playing live, like, now I, in the cover band I play in now, I don't use one. And I wish I did. But like when I play in the other, like the original bands I play with, cause I was playing with another band, I did a week and a half long tour back last, not this past November, but the one before, with this band called The Victory Drive. Uh-huh. And, when I got back with them, I was like, you play to a click, right? And he goes, yeah. I'm like, oh, thank God. You know, and he was like, you're the first drummer I ever talked to that was happy about that.
And there's people that swear by a click. And then there's some people like, I don't even want to deal with that. But I think a lot of people, especially today, like, if you can't play to a click, then you're really lost.
Oh, yeah. And it's expected anymore. You know, like, pretty much every band that I talk to plays to a click live. And if they don't, I ask them why they don't. There has to be a reason.
Especially in a live setting. Like, I don't think you, like, a lot of the national bands that are out there, 9 times out of 10, they're playing to clicks the whole time.
The only band I can think of that's, like, significant, I don't know who that Facebook user was that said TVD, haha, love Jamie.
Yeah, I'm going to go look at that.
But a lot of times, like, the only band I can think of is Foo Fighters that doesn't play to one live. Everybody else I can think of. Yeah, like, even a lot of the older bands. Dude, Joey Creamer, the drummer from Aerosmith, when they were playing on an award show, he couldn't play to a click live, and they had to have another drummer come in.
Wow.
Yeah, like, talk about humiliating, man.
Yeah.
Like, you've been playing in this band for 40 years, and you can't play to a metronome live? Like, I understand you've never had to do it, but,
right.
Lord, didn't you play to a click in the studio at least?
Exactly. So. Yeah, I guess, especially in that time, I mean, you know, playing to certain metronomes and stuff like that was, you know, just frowned upon. But then, like, you know, especially in now, like we said, nowadays it's more common. So it's like trying to learn, teaching an old dog new tricks. So,
right. And I was watching. Do you ever watch that live from Daryl's house?
I don't think so.
It's Daryl Hall from Hall & Oates.
I don't think so. Doesn't come.
No, dude, it's so good. He started a YouTube series that then ended up getting picked up by VH1, I think. But it's live from Daryl's house, and all it is he has his friends like Kenny Loggins, for example, but he also had Patrick Stump from Fall Out Boy, oddly enough.
Oh wow, nice!
They come in and they play some Hall & Oates songs. They play some songs from whoever the artist is, and then they do an interview, and it's really cool. But one of the things that he was talking to I think he was talking to Patrick from Fall Out Boy, and the one person that he was talking to, he was just like, "Yeah, you guys play to a click live, right?" And he goes, "Yeah," and he goes, "Yeah. We were one of the first bands to do that." He said, "We used to have a drum machine that we would pump into the monitor of the drummer on stage, and that's what he would play to."
Hmm.
And it's like, wow, that's interesting. Like, who'd have thought, back in the 80s that they were doing that sort of thing? So back then it used to be they would have sequencers where, like, it would just be a repeating pattern that would play through the whole song, but there was no actual click to lock into.
Hmm.
So... Who said, ha ha, I love Jamie?
Oh, that's David Earl again. So.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Yeah, guys, so I think we are reaching that ending of the show tonight. I got to definitely give a lot of love to Kevin tonight for coming on and spending some time with me. It's been a little while since we've got to have a good conversation together. I mean, you know, since you've been in Florida for three years
in March.
So yeah, it's been a while, and you know, so hopefully when this pandemic ends, we can actually once you come back up to near the Delco area, we can you know, hang out, you know.
Dude, we'll double up on a show.
Yeah, man, that'd be cool. Before we get out of here, do you have any other shows coming up right now that you have booked, or?
Nope, not really. I have a few cover band shows that I'm playing. I'm playing next weekend. What am I playing again? Yeah, I got a private gig next weekend, but
gotcha.
Aside from that, no, it's just all cover band stuff right now.
Gotcha, gotcha.
There was brief talk of flying up for... I have flown up a few times and, like, see my dad and stuff.
Uh-huh.
There was brief talk of me flying up to do the Victory Drive show that he's doing in Atlantic City in, like, a few weeks, but I don't know if that's going to happen or not. I haven't seen Jamie in, like, over a year, and when he announced the show, I was like, if you want to do it as a duo, I'll fly in and I'll play guitar. And then he was like, well, actually, if you're going to do that, maybe we'll just do full band. And I was like, okay, well, you know, let me know.
Right. And so on the same fact, I do have a show this weekend. It was kind of a last minute thing, but I'm going to be playing in Royersford, PA. So, I'm going to be playing at a, bar restaurant called Tom's Bar and Grill. So if anybody is in the area, feel free to come out. I'll be playing from, 7 to 10. It seems like they do have inside dining. I think it's going to be too cold for their outside dining, but it seems like they do have a big open area. So, you know, masks will be worn. I'm pretty sure there'll be, you know, enough social distancing.
There better be.
So, if anybody is in the area, feel free to come. And I'm going to be live streaming the show as well. So make sure to tune in on the Facebook account here, Spoken Life Music. I'll be doing some live streaming. I usually do about 2-3 sets. Usually I like doing longer sets than doing like 3 45-minute sets for a 3-hour show. I like playing about an hour and 15, taking a 15-20-minute break and then getting on, because I think 45 minutes is, like, for me, like, what I feel like it takes me a little bit to get into a rhythm, and then if I do like a 45-minute set, I feel it takes me a little bit to get into a rhythm, and then when I get into a rhythm, it's like, okay, then I gotta take a break. So I feel an hour and 15, it's enough to kind of warm up and then get into that groove, and then, like, okay, let me take a break, get something to eat, and then get back into it. So
yeah, I feel you.
So it'll be nice to kind of get back out to play. I haven't had a show since October, other than doing table talk here. So it'll be nice to get out and perform for a couple hours.
Yeah, I've been fortunate. I've been gigging like at least every other. We have the place that we're playing in like 2 weeks. We got booked the first and third Saturdays there all through 2021. So. I at least know I have 2 gigs a month every month, but I mean, coming from doing 3 to 5 a week, it sucks. I'm fortunate that my teaching business is going great guns, and, you know, I'm not relying on gigs now, thank God.
Right,
you know?
Yeah.
But I would rather drop some students and gig more, you know, than...
Of course.
Than have 30 students, which is what I have now, which is killing me, than... then play one gig every other freaking weekend.
Yeah. Well, I heard something where that depending on how this vaccine goes, that live music, depending on the vaccine, like, I guess the how everything's going to go in the next couple months, that live music should start making a comeback by the fall of this year. So
yeah, that's kind of what I'm thinking. And, like, I know one of the company, it was Johnson & Johnson, I think I just read, they have 500 million doses, like, ready to go. They're just waiting for their approval, I think.
Yeah. So yeah. So
when it's funny, I was watching or I was reading about the vaccine, and apparently the first vaccine, I guess the Pfizer one, they figured it out in 2 days. So I was just like, and it's an mRNA, so I mean, like,
yeah, there's a lot of information on mRNA viruses, but I don't think there's a lot of research that goes into it. So I think that's one of the reasons why a lot of people are, you know, not wanting to take it, just because there's not too much research on it. but, you know, it's kind of on the safe fact that, you know, it's kind of like, you know, you're taking a risk, but you know you're going to at least be immune for X amount of time, because we don't know how immune you're going to be and for how long. But everybody's taking a risk, just like, you know, they have been for the last year. They've been taking a risk by, you know, going out and working everywhere, so.
Right, and I mean, like, it's to me, when people are saying, like, I'm not taking a vaccine, blah, blah, blah. I'm just like, dude, if they figured it out in 2 days, the likelihood that it's not been well enough researched, at least, you know, or that it was that difficult to come up with, I feel like it's kind of slim. You know, if somebody unravels a medical thing that fast, and what it really was probably a guy before lunch figured it out and shot an email out to a few other assholes, and then they finally agreed to take it to management in 2 days. That was probably how it went.
Yeah, I think so. I doubt it
was the... What?
It's like, hey, I think I got it.
Yeah, so, like, knowing that it took them exactly that long to figure it out, I'm like, oh, no, go ahead, jab me. I don't care, you know?
Yeah, I mean, like I said, knowing me, that, you know, I'm in the science field, you know, I know there's a lot of people, and like I said, we're not getting too into it, but, like, there's a lot of people that are for science, that are against science, and just, like, with everything, but, you know, you got to just trust in it to a certain extent, and because there's got to be an end to it eventually. So you know, no matter how it's going to be, there's going to have to be some type of way that we're going to have to get you know, some type of herd immunity. So that's the easiest way. So let's just all we got to do is just hope and pray that everything kind of goes the way it should, and that we can hopefully have a better year by, you know, this time next year, if anything.
Yep.
So but thank you guys for being here. I really hope you guys enjoyed yourselves tonight. I did. Thank you, Kevin, for being on here again. We'll have to do this again very soon. And I will see you guys on the next episode of Table Talk. Hope you guys have a great rest of your night. I will see you on the next one. Thank you, guys. Have a good night.